Amen. Well, let me read something to you here out of Matthew chapter 21. When you get there, say, I'm there. All right. Praise God. That's one. Amen. Let me read as we follow. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. I might. Sorry, guys, let me try this again. You'll find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone asks anything, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the colt, and they laid their clothes on them, and they set them on him. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before them, who followed, crying out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? Let's pray for a moment. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, that you would open my mind, my heart, that you would open our minds and our hearts, and that you would touch us today, that we might see and recognize the King. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys are going to have to give me just a minute. I'm having some problems thinking this morning. So Pastor Lauren may be coming up here if I can't finish this. But I've got a chronological Bible. Does everybody know what that means? It means, you know, the Bibles most of us have are not in chronological order. And I was reading this past week, or 2 weeks ago actually, in Numbers. And as I was reading in the book of Numbers, I was reading this story in Numbers 22 through 24, where this king from Moab named Balak had summoned this guy from Balaam, who was a prophet. He was a wicked prophet. He was not a good prophet. And he called them because he saw that Israel had just came through the... He saw that the country that they just came from, the Israelites, came through, and they pretty much knocked them out. And so he came and he says, listen, I want you to put a curse on them. And so through a series of events, Balaam decides to go, and he gets on this donkey, something like that. And he gets on this donkey, and he begins to take off to put this curse on the Israelites. And as he's going, this donkey sees, the Bible says, an angel of the Lord who had drawn his sword. And so the donkey, being scared, runs out into this field. And Balaam, who doesn't see the angel of the Lord, begins to beat him. And just beat him until he gets back on to the road. And so as he gets on the road, he goes down a little further, and there the angel of the Lord is again. And the donkey sees him again, and he begins to run to the side so that he could get past the angel. And as he goes past him, he crushes Balaam's foot. And so here he is again. He's beating his donkey. How many have ever beat your donkey? It's water. And so he's beating his donkey. And so a third time, he gets back on the road. Thank you. He gets back on the road, and he's beginning to head down. And once again, there's the angel of the Lord with his sword drawn. And this time, the donkey just lays down. And as he lays there, Balaam gets off, and he begins just to beat him and beat him and beat him. And the donkey didn't get up. And in verse 28 of chapter 24 of the book of Numbers, the Bible says this. It says, the Lord gave the donkey the ability to speak. Now, I want to stop for a moment. Has anybody ever had a donkey speak to them? Because if you did, you come up here and preach. Because you got a word. The donkey began to speak, and he began to have a conversation with the donkey. Now, for me, I'd have been changing my clothes. But he began to speak. I guess it's kind of like Siri. Do you ever try to have a conversation with Siri? I do all the time. If you ask her questions, you can have a conversation with her. And he begins to speak to this donkey, and finally the donkey says these words. He says, "Haven't I been faithful to you all these years?" And Balaam says, "Well, yeah." And so finally what ends up happening is he begins to see the angel of the Lord, the presence of God, Jesus. It was Jesus standing in the road with his sword drawn. And he begins to see him, and he falls down, and he basically says, "I'm sorry, I was in your presence, and I didn't even recognize your presence." And it took a donkey to get a message to this prophet. We see about Balaam a couple times in the New Testament. Here's one of them in 2 Peter 2:15. It says, this is Peter talking about bad prophets, wicked prophets. Today it would be churches who are apostate churches who have left the teachings of Jesus. And he says this, "They have left the straight and way and wandered off and followed the way of Balaam, son of Beor, who loved the wages of wickedness, but he was rebuked for his wrongdoing by a donkey, an animal without speech, who spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness." I wonder if donkeys still speak today. I think they do. I think that's what the Psalms is all about. I think it's all about God speaking and showing his presence. And he began to speak. I believe he does, and I believe this Psalm Sunday, this celebration week of Palm Sunday, where we celebrate, and we had a great time this morning, and I hope we're going to have a great time the rest of the day. They celebrate, and they begin to see what Jesus is about to do. They begin to somewhat recognize who Jesus is. And we know at the end of the week, they change their palm branches for thorns from a tree. But at this moment, at this time, they were celebrating. And as they were celebrating, I believe they were celebrating because they began to hear a message. You know, it took Balaam a little bit of time to see that this donkey had a message. Or at least this donkey could see the presence of God. And I think it takes a little bit of time for us, for them back then, to see that this donkey was also bringing a message. This donkey brought this message. And for us today, I don't think it's just a message to a person. I think it's a message to all of us, past, present, and future. I think that's what he wants to do. And here's one of the messages that the donkey brings. It's to help you and me see the King. You know, I often wondered as we read this earlier, it seems like you could probably have gone without having read this in the narrative, read about the donkey, probably could have read that and still would have understood what Jesus was trying to do, still could have understood what Palm Sunday was about. He was about to do that. Even though in some of the narratives in the four Gospels, they didn't include it, but here Matthew includes it. But you could have read it and not, you'd have been okay. You'd have still understood what was going on. But what really bewilders me as I read this time and time and time again, is that verse 3. And verse 3 says, "The Lord needs it." Now Jesus, as far as I know, was never a needy person. I mean, John 4, it talks about how Jesus was sitting and talking to a Samaritan woman and he asked her for a drink of water, which, by the way, he never got. But as he was there, he needed a drink of water. John 19, when he's on the cross, he again asked for a drink of water. But really, in Jesus' life and ministry, as we read the Gospels, as we read the red letters, we don't really see Jesus being someone who is a needy person. He never really needed anything, but yet he needs a donkey. Why does he need a donkey? He needs a donkey so he can bring a message. I think the way that he was trying to bring this to bear, Matthew pretty much says, it says, behold, take a close look. Behold, it says this in verse 5, behold, your king is coming, lowly and riding on a donkey. I think what he's trying to say, and if you go back to Zechariah in the Old Testament, a couple hundred years before, it says this, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion, shout, O daughter of Jerusalem, behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. I think what he was doing was confirming the word in the Old Testament about what he was doing. He was confirming that I'm your king. And as they came in, he was saying, I'm your king. Now think about it for a moment. Jesus, for most of his ministry, used to tell people when he did miracles or when he touched them, he would say, don't tell anybody. Go to the priest, show yourself to the priest. But the guy in John 9, he opens his eyes, he's been blind from birth. He says, don't do that. He says, just don't tell anybody. And all through his ministry, he told people, even his disciples, don't tell anybody. Matthew chapter 16, when Peter finally gets it, he says, well, you're the Son of God. He tells him, don't tell anybody. But now he's riding in, and he is saying, I am your king. Take a look. Look at who I am. I am your king. Behold, that's what that word means. Behold, it means to stop, to take a look, to do that. Wow. It's kind of like, behold is one of those things like when you first saw your wife. Like when I first saw my wife, I was like, oh, I got to stop. I got to take a look. Wow. Some of you understand what I'm saying. Maybe, I hope. But it was like one of those wow moments. And that's what that word means. Stop. Wow. Look. Take a look. Here I am. I'm coming in to the kingdom. I'm coming into Zion. I'm coming in to Jerusalem. You remember, he had a price on his head. He had raised Lazarus from the dead. And once he did that, they were trying to kill him. And he rides right into the place where they were trying to kill him. And he has him. And he has this message. He says, take a look. You guys understand. The donkey rode into this place, confirming. His message was confirming. His message, this donkey was confirming Jesus' message that I am your awaited Messiah. I'm the one you've been waiting on. And for a moment, they got it. For a moment, they understood what Jesus was saying and who he was. And they laid down their palms and they laid down their jackets and their clothes, the Bible says, and they laid them down on the road as Jesus rode in on this donkey and this little foal. God is just beginning to say, listen, take a look. I want you to recognize who I am. What do you do when the king comes to your presence? What do we do when we have that ah moment, that wow moment, that Jesus did this kind of moment? When we see the king, you understand what I'm saying? What do we do when we see the king, and what do we lay at his feet? Because he's still the king, amen? What do we do? What do we lay at his feet? I mean, he says, cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. This donkey spoke this message that was in the Old Testament. He was telling him this moment that, hey, I'm bringing in the king. Take a look. Be wowed. Don't forget to raise your hands, raise your palms, and begin to love him and begin to worship him. But he spoke another message. And that message is this. He helps you and me see what kind of king Jesus is. That's what the donkey, actually the colt, the Bible tells us that he was riding on the foal. You see, when Jesus walked in, or when a conquering king walked in, or he came into his place, his home, and he was confirming that he was victor, he would go in on the tallest horse. Not just the medium-sized horse or the big horse, the tallest horse you could ever get. And he's riding on this tallest horse, but Jesus is riding on a donkey. You got the tallest horse, you got the medium horse, you got the little horse, you got the donkey, and then you got the foal. And that's what Jesus was riding on, the foal of a donkey. How was he, and why was he doing that? What was he saying? I think he was trying to tell the people then and us today that he's not the kind of king that at least they wanted, and he's not the kind of king sometimes that we want. They weren't looking for a conquering king for eternity. They were looking for a conquering king for temporarily. See, that's the difference. Jesus wrote in the message that this donkey was saying, that the foal, this colt of this donkey, was basically saying, I'm bringing you an eternal salvation. Not a temporary fix. An eternal salvation for your eternity. Not just for today, but for every day. For your past, your present, and your future. And that's the kind of king I am. I'm a savior king. I'm a savior king. I'm the prince of peace. I'm that kind of king. They didn't catch that. They were worshiping. They were praising. They caught the fact that Jesus was a king. They got that. But they really didn't get what kind of king he was. And I think sometimes we may not get it ourselves. I think sometimes we look for a quick fix king. Hello. See, sometimes we look for a quick fix king because when our king tells us to that a quick fix king is someone who's going to just kind of take care of the moment, just kind of take care of my house payment, just kind of take care of my marriage, just kind of take care of, it's kind of like those foxhole prayers. Anybody ever prayed those? You're in the foxhole and the enemy's coming and you're about ready to get bombed. And you say, Lord Jesus, if you would just do this for me, then I will, and fill in the blank with whatever you will do. And it's a quick fix king. And sometimes you pray that and then you end up praying that again and again and again. Because sometimes we look at Jesus as just a quick fix king, and he's more than that. Sometimes we look at Jesus as a scared to approach king. You know, we don't live in a monarchy and we don't have a king as our leader. We have a president, but I guarantee you can't just walk up to the president, and you couldn't just walk up to the king. If you watch movies or if you read back in the Bible where there was a monarchy, there was kings, and you just didn't walk up to them. And sometimes we feel like we can't get to this king. We feel like we've done so much wrong. We feel like we've done so much bad, and we're scared to approach him. But our king says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's what our king says. Sometimes I think we look at Jesus as a demanding king. I got to do this. I got to do this. I got to have this right. I got to have that right. Oh my gosh, I didn't do this. I didn't pray long enough. I didn't love good enough. Blah, blah, blah. And the list goes on and on and on and on. And we can never meet the king's demands. But our king says, our savior king, our prince of peace king, he says, I'm full of grace and full of truth. And you can approach me. I don't demand anything from you. Just believe. That's what the kind of king Jesus is. It's the kind of king Jesus was and is. 1 Timothy 6:15 tells us that he is the king of kings. So he's king over all those things. He's king over our house payment and our marriage. He's king over, but he's an eternal king. What do you see when you look at Jesus? Do you see a quick fix? Do you see a king who might be telling you, forgive? So that you can be forgiven. He might be telling you, don't curse, but bless those who curse you. and spitefully use you. That's not the kind of king they wanted. They wanted him to come in and conquer the Roman Empire and be done with it. And I think we do too sometimes. Lord, if you just take care of that. Lord, if you could just help my wife not talk so much, Lord. He came in to Jerusalem as the king, triumphant king. And he was king over sin. He came in king over sin, over death. He came in, Jesus came in king over greed. You know how he did that? Because he gave. He gave his life. He came in over to kill and to beat rage and hate because he gave meekness and gentleness. He came in to speak truth and love. What kind of king do you see? What kind of king do you see? Last message that this last message that Matthew was talking about. Excuse me. Give me 1 second here, guys. Last message that he was talking about, and he was talking about in the Old Testament. And the last message is this. It's our response, your response, my response, our response of what we do when we recognize the King. They were actually talking about Psalms 118. And it says this. Save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, and send now prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, and he has given us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. He's talking about the word Hosanna. It means save now. Save now. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Save now. He's coming in, and they got it. They understood it for just a moment. They understood that Jesus was the King. And as they came in, they were worshiping and praising and thanking him and blessing him. Hosanna, Hosanna. You ever been in a church, kind of like this morning, where people just let loose? Amen? You ever been there? Like it's like, whoo, glory. Glory to God. You know, it's okay to do that. It's okay to do that here. Because when we see Jesus, when we see that he has saved us now, when we see that he has done things in our lives, man, you just let loose. There's so much joy in us. There's so much love for us, through us. And we just give it up, man. Hosanna. And that's what they were doing. Think about it for a moment. Think as he was coming down the road and there was this small rumble. And as they come a little closer and a little closer and a little closer and it begins to get louder and louder and louder and louder. Hosanna! Hosanna! See, the donkey was telling them, this is what you do when the king comes in. This is how you do it. Think about it. When Jesus came to this planet, first and foremost, there was no worship. There was no accolades. There was just a baby and some animals, probably a donkey. There were some angels who said, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, peace and goodwill towards men. But it wasn't people who he died for, who didn't get it, who didn't understand it. He was reading Matthew was talking about what he was talking about. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Now they're singing. Now they're praising. Now he is the Messiah, and they saw it. You know, one of the things that's really interesting in Luke, if you see this story in Luke, if you remember, I think I even mentioned this last week, that they were, the religious leaders looked at Jesus and said, tell your disciples to be quiet, because they understood. Tell your disciples to be quiet, because they understood that he can't do that. They can't tell you that you're the king. People are understanding that you're the king. How do you do that? And Jesus is saying, listen, if these guys be quiet, even the rocks, even the stones would come out. They would begin to, even creation itself understood that Jesus was king. And when they understood that Jesus is king, they understood and recognized what they were supposed to do. And that's to worship. And that's to praise. That's to put our palms up, if you will, and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's what he's done. What's your response? What's your response when you recognize, not just in a church service, which I wish we do that more often, but what's your response when you recognize that Jesus has saved and has fulfilled and has sustained and has, keeps you? What is your response in the mountains and the valleys of life? What do we do? I think what we're supposed to do is worship and praise. Amen? Worship and praise. Amen? Amen. Amen. Dorney, I'm going to get you and the band to come on up here. God used a donkey in the Old Testament to get to a guy named Balaam so that he could see what he was doing. God used a donkey, but he used a donkey also in the New Testament so that he could tell his people that his presence is here, that God is here. I think today, if you've recognized the King, if you know Jesus to be your King, if you know Jesus is doing something in your life or has begun to do something in your life, if you've recognized that, I think a great way to honor him, a great way to understand the message for this moment is let's worship him. And so this morning, I want to do that. I want to sing to the King. Would you do that with me today? Let's all stand this morning. Amen. people coming in Jerusalem, laying down their clothes, laying down their branches, palm branches. Verse 10 says that as that was happening, verse 10 says, many people, or a lot of people, were saying, who is this? They saw Jesus coming in. They saw the people praising. They realized that he might be a king. They saw the response. But there were people who still didn't know who Jesus was. And this morning, if that's you, if you are saying, you know, I don't really get it. I mean, I've been to church, and I'm probably going to come to church next week. But if you don't really get who Jesus is, today is the day. Today is the day of salvation. Would you allow Jesus to come into your life? Would you allow Jesus to be your king? And would you respond to him? Would you respond to the king? All you have to do is ask him. All you have to do is say, Lord, here I am. Take me. Take my sin. I give you my life. Would you do that this morning? Do that right now in your heart. And let's sing to the King as we go out.